Please rise as you are able and join me in the invitation to gather. Give us the spirit of the child. Give us the spirit of the child who lives within. The child who receives without reservation, the child who gives without judgment. Give us the child's ears that we may hear the music of mythical times. Give us a child's faith that we may be cured of our cynicism. Dear God, we come together this morning to open up to you. If we open a silent door into our own hearts and minds, we can find a remembered child we once were. We were once as open to possibilities as the children here this morning. Help us join them to experience wonder and more. These children still know your unvarnished truths just as we once did. They know when an adult is pretending to be good, or says, "I'm not angry," with a grimace that says, "untrue." Help us to see again through their eyes, past all our grown-up defenses. May we be open to the young ones still in our hearts. Help us to be humble, to see our foibles and laugh. And Lord, if we can do that, will you laugh with us? Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to New England Congregational Church on this beautiful morning. A very special welcome to those who may be guests among us. Please take a moment and record your attendance in the friendship register located in your pew and pass them to your neighbor. Following worship, we invite you to join us in the Memorial Garden for a time of fellowship and conversation. Thank you to all those who are involved in this morning's service, to our liturgist Maureen, to Marsha, our organist, to our soloist Heather, to Cathy and the members of the New England Carillon, to Josh in the sound booth, and to our ushers and greeters. This afternoon, we invite you back again at 3 p.m. to meet with Gary McCann and I for an informational session on the New England trip to Romania and Ukraine in October of 2023. Come to learn more and have your questions answered. Next Sunday, after worship, Rick Guzman will offer a special informational program on New England's Emmanuel House and the Neighbor Project in the parlor. Rick will discuss the ins and outs of this successful program, helping families move from renting to owning a home here in Aurora, and we invite you to plan on attending. Please take a look at the additional notices printed in your bulletin for information about our upcoming Blessing of the Animal service, film series, and family orchard outing. And now, know that no matter who you are or where you are in your journey of life or faith, you are welcome here. We continue in worship with our ministry of music. This morning, it is a joy to be officially welcoming those new members of New England Congregational Church that were confirmed this past spring. We celebrate their presence among us and honor their commitment with the gifting of name tags. Students, as your name is read, please come forward to receive your name tag and remain here in the chancel until all the names have been read. Friends in the congregation, please hold your applause until the end. Matthew Gordon. Mitchell Grometer. Dylan Kokinos. Abigail Lechecki. Jack Myers. Natalie Myers. Casey Roney. Ella Schwab. Luke Svensson. And Reno Verali. We welcome you now and look forward to the ways in which you will grow and mature among us, and the ways you will stretch and challenge us to grow as a community of faith. Welcome. And now we invite our children forward. So I'm going to start this morning with a question, and whenever you're ready, you can respond. What is your favorite thing about being a kid?
Playing blocks.
Okay, what was it?
Blocks.
Playing video games. Seeing animals. Being a brother. Not having a job. And we got a second up here. Any other things that are your favorite about being a kid? Not having much responsibility, playing with friends? What was that? Videos. You don't have to work? That's right. Anybody else?
No.
Okay. That's a pretty good list. Video games are always good. That is a pretty good list. I have to be honest, after hearing all of those great answers, I kind of think I'd like to be a kid again, too. I remember when I was your age, I could not wait to grow up. I wanted to live in my own house, I wanted to make my own rules, and I wanted to make my own money. Let me tell you all, it's not all it's cracked up to be. So today I have a simple message for you. I want you to enjoy all the wonderful things about being a kid. Just enjoy it. Run and play, color and build, dig and laugh, and listen and learn and grow, but don't grow up too fast. Enjoy being exactly who you are right now. Let's share a prayer together. And video games. Dear God, thank you for childhood. It's a magical time of dreaming and learning.
exploring and hoping, possibility and promise. We pray blessings on each of these special kids as they do all the things kids do. Help them to enjoy it. And help them know that they are loved by you and by us. Amen. Thank you all for coming. You can head to your church school classes.
This morning, as we prepare for our time of prayer, we remember Susan Sharp as she undergoes emergency surgery this morning following a ruptured brain aneurysm. Our prayers for her, for Ken, for their family, and for her care team. And now let us be together in a spirit of prayer. Womb of life and source of being. There are times when we wonder how we'll make it through the struggles of today. If good will triumph in our world, if the choices we make will lead to the life we long to live. Remind us that you are always birthing newness in our midst. As the seasons begin once again to turn, as grass turns gold and leaves turn orange, as days grow cooler and nights are chill with the autumn air, remind us that you are always birthing newness in our midst. As we rise each day, aware of the challenges it's sure to hold, as we collapse exhausted into bed each night, as we prepare for another meeting, another test, another doctor's appointment, another procedure, remind us that you are always birthing newness in our midst. As we consider the violence in our world, the fragile peace among nations, the unstable balance of nature, the needs of our human family, remind us that you are always birthing newness in our midst. May your newness come to us, to this congregation, to this community, to our nation, and to our world. Inspire and equip us to join you in bringing about the change you long to see, even as Jesus did, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Epistle of James, 3rd chapter. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace. Here ends the reading.
Hear now a second reading, this one from the Gospel according to Mark, the 9th chapter. Jesus and the disciples went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying, and were afraid to ask him. Then, when they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for they had argued about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all, and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." Here ends the reading. The Nobel laureate in physics, Dr. Isidore Rabi, was once asked why he became a scientist instead of a doctor, or a lawyer, or a businessman, like all the other immigrant kids in his neighborhood. His answer was profound. My mother made me a scientist without ever intending it. Every other Jewish mother in Brooklyn would ask her child after school, "So, did you learn anything today?" But not my mother. She always asked me a different question. "Izzy," she would say, "did you ask a good question today?" That difference, asking good questions, made me become a scientist. I'll never forget the day that my own father asked my brother, 4 years my junior, what he had learned in kindergarten. My brother responded flatly, "Sex." We were not what you would call a progressive family. And there is no doubt that my father would have thought kindergarten far too young for such a conversation. "What do you mean?" he asked my brother. "Today we learned about sex," he responded. Concerned, my dad asked, "What exactly did you learn about sex?" My brother answered cheerfully, "You know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, sex." While adults may curiously ask children what they learned or what question they asked, most of us expect children to be inquisitive, to ask lots of questions. In fact, in a fairly recent British study of 1,500 households, researchers determined that kids ask an average of 73 questions per day. For young parents or expecting parents among us this morning, you'll be pleased to know that the study also revealed that a child's inquisitive nature peaks at age 4. Hopefully, that is good news. The researchers compiled a list of the top 10 most challenging questions children typically ask, and I thought you might be entertained or impressed to hear them. Firstly, why do people die? Secondly, where did I come from? Thirdly, what is God? Fourth, how was I made? Fifth, what does "we can't afford it" mean? Six, is Father Christmas real? Seven, why do I have to go to school? Eight, when you die, who will I live with? Nine, why is the sky blue? And 10, why can't I stay up as late as you do? Children are naturally curious about the world around them. They have questions and they want answers. Jesus' disciples weren't so different. In the reading I shared a few moments ago from Mark's gospel, Jesus was teaching, and as per usual, the disciples didn't understand what he was saying. However, the author tells us that they were afraid to ask him. And therein lies one of the big differences between children and adults. For children, the world is a secret garden to be explored, full of mysteries to be unlocked. They don't pretend to have all the answers, and their imaginations fill in the gaps in their knowledge. They're not afraid to ask questions, and they genuinely believe that the adults in their lives have the answers. For adults, on the other hand, the world can be a scary place because we know too much to explore. We're often too afraid to ask questions about its mysteries for fear of looking foolish. And we're often impatient with the children who ask too much and fearful for the children who explore too much. We know better. They don't. Simple. Except that even as adults, we still have questions. The disciples had questions. But like them, we too can be afraid to ask. The famed marine biologist Sylvia Earle once said, "The best scientists and explorers have the attributes of kids. They ask questions and have a sense of wonder. They have curiosity. Who, what, where, when, why, and how? They never stop asking questions, and I never stop asking questions, just like a 5-year-old. But so many of us do stop asking questions. At least we stop asking them out loud. The Jesus of Mark's gospel knew that there was something his friends weren't asking. So he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said, 'Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me.'" Later in Mark's gospel, Jesus says, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." Children in Jesus' time had little value. Of course, their parents loved them, but infant mortality rates were very high. And of the babies that survived infancy, less than half would reach adulthood. Theologians and commentators tell us that in naming children the inheritors of the realm of heaven, Jesus was flipping conventional wisdom on its head and bestowing value where society did not, on the children. But I don't think that's the only reason Jesus had for lifting up their example. Jesus knew that children aren't afraid of questions, aren't encumbered by conventional wisdom, aren't satisfied just to sit still. And when we become like the children, tireless in our quest for knowledge, boundless in our exploration of mystery, fearless in the face of the unknown and in the face of the unknowable, then, and only then, do we welcome Jesus in our midst. Now, we at New England Church profess to be a caring church for thinking people. We state that we do not profess to have all the answers to life's questions, but we believe that by joining together in worship, prayer, and social gatherings, we can walk with one another through the difficult times and better discern God's ways in our lives. We claim to value the individual's experience of the divine and create opportunities for children and youth to explore faith and learn from the Christian tradition. We state as goals of our confirmation program to create a safe space for young people to honestly and authentically explore faith, doubt, meaning, to stretch our students' critical thinking skills so they can face questions and challenges to their own dearly held beliefs without fear or inability to hear other perspectives, and to prepare them for a faith journey that includes ongoing re-evaluation over time and the flexibility to change when they encounter new information or new inspiration. And we claim to value good questions over right answers. This, friends, is who we say we are and who we believe we are called to be. And so today, as we remember Jesus pulling a child in close and telling his friends that whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, let's commit ourselves anew to welcoming the children among us and to nurturing the child spirit within us, to having more questions than answers, to wondering more and knowing less, to living the questions each and every day as individuals and as a community of faith. On the quest for answers, Rainier Maria Rilke once said this, and I close with his words. Don't search for the answers which could not be given to you now, because you would not be able to live them. And the point is to live everything. So live the questions now. Perhaps then, someday far in the future, you will gradually, without even noticing it, live your way into the answer. May it be so with us. Amen.
dedicate these gifts in the hope that all Earth's children have a home, have the food they need to thrive, the education they need to grow, the love they need to blossom. And we pledge ourselves to give and to work until it is so. Amen. Please be seated.
And now, dear friends, let us go forth and live the questions. And may God be with you as you go, above you to watch over you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, and within you to give you peace this day and all your days. Amen.